paper review. In this video, I'm going to go through the paper Mastering Chess and Shogi by Self-Playing with a General Reinforcement Learning Algorithm. This is a paper by DeepMind tied to Google. And it's probably the only chess video that proper chess game related video that I'm going to make. And I have to say upfront that I don't know too much about chess. 2 weeks ago, another YouTuber called Otium sent me down a rabbit hole to a bunch of content creators who are really into chess. And I found it's very fun to watch YouTubers discuss their 100-year-old favorite chess games. And it's an interesting space. And so I'm motivated. I'm going to go through a little bit of our technical paper. And as I am myself just learning these kind of things, this should be considered a kind of introduction to the bullet points as I discovered them in the last 2 weeks. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the algorithm, which are relevant, and you're going to get links to a bunch of other resources and videos and how I view it. And it also has a little bit to do with set theory, which is recently the main content on my channel. In that Zermelo, after which Zermelo-Frankel set theory is named, actually wrote what you can call the first game theory paper, and he wrote on chess and proved some relevant theorems still relevant today. In that sense, it relates a little bit to set theory, let's say. Okay, so but since it's also very introductory topic for me, the half of the video will just consist of me going through a bunch of bullet points, a bunch of YouTube links that I recommend and Wikipedia pages, and I will comment on them. And only the second half will be like actually going through the paper. So this video is targeted at people who just know as much as I did 2 weeks ago, but I think it's going to be interesting nevertheless. Okay, so the paper is 3 years old. It's available on the archive, and we're going to get into that after I go through a bunch of links. So for starters, of course, AlphaZero is that computer program by DeepMind, which was, I think, acquired by Google a few years ago. They are kind of the deep learning, artificial intelligence branch, or at least one of them that Google has. And it rose to fame by, you know, tackling several challenges in abstraction and strength in developing these machine learning algorithms. There is just general machine learning stuff that I found interesting. I don't want to hold myself up with that at this point so much, but you can get the history introduction that I found quite readable, even for Wikipedia. Here on the DeepMind side in the technology sections, and then if you click from there, the people, like this paper, as you have maybe just seen, is by a bunch of people. I think they are all in the DeepMind group there, but these are not the only researchers here. And a lot of them are actually also they have huge bios and are famous researchers themselves. So if you just follow along with them, I will give you some pointers to the work of these guys in a second as well. Okay, this is just Google page. And I will play this actually like a chess game. After each page that I have, I will close the page, so I make a move and then I cannot go back. So that's that. They have a YouTube channel with this peculiar layout and colors, where there are also some quite technical talks. So I looked into some of the videos. Some of them are kind of fluffy, but others are just really AI machine learning lectures. As always, you will find the links in a GIST at the bottom. And here are some generally relevant links into the topic. And also, of course, I motivate this video kind of by chess, and I talk about chess simply because I got back into playing a little bit in the last two weeks. But as the title of the paper says, this is a very general deep learning setup and algorithm that in particular also works well with other simple games like Go and so on and so forth. As we will see later, they emphasize that they design the system to be able to, like a human in a sense, be able to learn different various things. So, for example, other games, but also then video games, for example. And in this sense, it's there is not so much domain knowledge. This is one keyword that will pop up that gets into this. And do this the whole setup. We will also contrast it then with other chess algorithms, for example, and see how other algorithms are much more specific. Okay, this is just another general page. Machine learning is a huge area, and here I'm just going down the road, narrowing it down a little bit first. So, for example, if I say deep learning, then this is also a little bit more specific than the whole range of all machine learning approaches. And here we talk about reinforcement learning, but again, since I want to keep this video under 1 hour, I'm just saying this is a relevant buzzword, and you should get into that if you want to have a clearer distinction of these algorithms in the context of this field. Okay, I have a video called Writing an Artificial General Intelligence from Scratch, in which I do just some Python coding, really. So here it's not a general artificial intelligence, to be honest. It's just a Python script, but from scratch, with the standard library that solves the NIST digit recognition problem. So let's see. Here in the end, maybe we see it. So if you're interested also in some coding, this is literally a from scratch, just standard library, 1 hour coding up in Python, an algorithm that in the end is able to recognize these digits. So it tells you, oh, this is a free, and so on and so forth. Okay, self-advertisement, of course, subscribe to this channel. And then there's a fun video. This is popular, has also 10 million views, where one guy here explains in 6 minutes roughly how he wrote a machine learning algorithm to learn play Super Mario. So that's also fun to watch. And he kind of speaks mostly about evolution and what it means for the machine learning algorithm to actually learn. And he makes some strong ties to evolutionary biology, for better or worse, as well. And then this paper that we're going to talk about, I'm actually not the first person to make a YouTube video about it. And in general, AlphaZero, you just Google it, and even if you Google the exact paper title, you will find some. I've looked into them. I didn't find other videos so great. I don't know if this one is better, but it's different in style for sure. Other people who try to bring the topic a little bit closer, or try to make it clear what the distinction is between what Google did here, or what DeepMind did here, and what has been done before, or what's different. There is this Jeff Heaton guy. There's one video that I like more than some others. So there's also another recommendation for a video which quite goes in that direction. And it's also not, this particular video is not directly about the paper, but like a little bit more broader context. And I think he steps here through some GitHub page and also explains some terms. Okay, so, and then there is Julian Schrittweiser, which, funny enough, is, I think, also, like me, a Viennese guy. But he's actually a co-author on the paper. So he... I looked at this LinkedIn, studied, I think, in a technical university, and made various internships, and then is now working in at DeepMind, and he has a video on a 10-minute video on that paper where he explains with some graphics that you also find in some of the papers. You just to go through them and also explain it. To be honest, I found it a little bit hard to follow along with that. So this might be a point if you already have you know, set up the layers of a machine learning algorithm, so if you know it a little bit better. But definitely is a recommendation. He only has 65 subscribers, so I don't know how much content he produces, but worth subscribing if you're into machine learning. Another Google page. So Otium invited me to some Discord with a bunch of young guys who are on the regular play chess tournaments, and they made me sign up to this website, leechess.org. This is also, I've not used this page much, but you can, like, all the time you watch live people play. So if you're actually into playing chess, this apparently seems the modern way to go. And we're going to talk a little bit about another chess program, an open source project called Stockfish. And the fun thing is, if you play here, a feature which is really great, which was not in existence 20 years ago, I suppose. After you play, you can actually look back at the game and consult what the AI would have done and so on. And I think this is super to learn that. Sadly, I probably don't have enough time to become in any way good at this game. But the last 2 weeks, what I've seen, I really like this community and their excitement for this 64 squares. Okay, and there is also a dedicated chess programming wiki. I cannot say how well it is maintained, but most of the terms that pop up in programming related to chess, and I'm sure some of the particular features to various chess programs and projects like Stockfish, you can also find here. So let's click on a random page if this page has this feature. Pages. Random page. Let's see. A guy made a bunch of chess programs. So this is a wiki from which you can also learn, and I'm certain that you find programming as well as chess playing instructions on that site. Let's get to one last random page here. Okay, conference. Okay. Good. Here also on this page, I scanned through some other papers by DeepMind as well. They have this paper that we're going to review is sort of oddly structured. I will come to that in a second. But they also have this sort of history block. I'm not sure if it was in this paper or in another paper, but they report of what happened in the past and how the chess programming got where it is a little bit. And for example, this this guy Sebastian Truhn pops up. I searched this guy also done on YouTube and watched some interviews, and he also did so many different things and working as you see here, university, also Google topics. And he is one of the guy who made in the 90s some influential chess program, I suppose. These are the people who we're going to talk about later in a second. I'm just pointing out that you also find these biographies on this chess programming wiki. Okay, so there is a award-winning a chess program, and it's an open source project called Stockfish. And funny enough, I have a friend, shout out to Ben, who I studied physics with, who was also, I think, a contributor to this program at one point. So he was very fond of it because it's very much has some nice math and statistics. So this is basically a benchmark program developed, I suppose, since a decade or longer. This always is the reference point, and what they will emphasize in the DeepMind paper is how these approaches to solving chess are much more domain specific. So they are actually much more chess specific, whereas the deep learning, reinforcement learning approach that we're going to see is actually not really tied to chess. It gets the rules of chess to, you know, actually play a proper game, but it has things are not tuned as much and tailored to actual chess. And they pointed out, and then the report of like in the paper, they will say and our system learned only in this short time and only played so and so many games, and then it won against some version of Stockfish. I don't want to go too deep already into the paper because we will quickly read through it anyway. But we will then also like have in the paper a whole paragraph comparing it from the algorithm side and what is novel. Although again, I have to say that since I have never implemented these algorithms myself, I can only report of them. Okay, so this is the stockfish.org website. They're on 11 now. I think 3 years ago when the paper came out, it was at 8. And there is the GitHub where the open sourcing takes place. So you see, I guess 5,000 commits. 5,000 is actually not that much compared to, for example, TensorFlow. Although I don't know what is running under the hood in here, and I don't know if or how much machine learning actually takes place. If you make machine learning broad enough and say machine learning is statistical fitting an approximation, then yes. But I'm not sure which other like popular routines Stockfish at the moment actually uses. So this video is not going to be about Stockfish much, but this is something good, so we want to actually learn some stochastics. Like my colleague Ben, then you can do it from reading Stockfish code. Yeah, okay, so this is what I said before. So there is this apparently 1913 paper by Zermelo, where he proves what is, I think, called Zermelo's theorem. It's a statement about, black and white in chess, what various parties can force, what outcomes they can force. Obviously, I'm not going to review this paper, but I would just want to point out that here is a historical sketch and comment on Zermelo's paper on the game theory. I've read that this is basically the first game theory paper. And after the conclusion, they have actually a translation of that short paper. So I think this paper is just 5 pages long, but here is this paper was called in the English translation, On an Application of Set Theory to the Theory of Games of Chess. And of course, there is also, as an aside, set theoretical axioms that are directly motivated by game theoretical considerations. So one buzzword is axiom of determinacy, but I'm not going to talk about set theory any further. Although I want to mention that at the moment I'm really into constructive Zermelo-Frenkel, or weaker versions of it actually, and I will make more videos on constructive set theory soon. So you can read along. So now we're going to quickly step through a bunch of Wikipedia pages that discuss major keywords. I, as I wrote the paper, I summarized the important ones that I found, and you can get to the GIST where you see all these links in this exact same order that I presented here, and check them out if you want to get into that. If you want to, for example, learn how to program a chess computer, which I recommend, I think it should be actually quite doable because the encoding of a chess game cannot be that complicated. I have not looked into that, how this is done in these computers. It's probably very efficient and so on, but in principle chess should be very straightforward. I mean, if you can work with arrays and then I suppose encode which steps are legal, then simply encoding a chess board should be more or less straightforward, I think, and then one can find out if you can write your own chess program from scratch, and after that you should actually look into the professional ones. I think that could be fun, and if somebody challenges me, if somebody wants, if you guys wants to work on writing such a thing as a learning experience, then let me know in the comments. I lingered on this side a little bit. You can read it or not, but basically now we're characterizing games such as chess. This is a perfect information. It's a feature competitive game, and that is present in chess, for example, and such games which exhibit this property are prone to being formalized in the sense that we'll see. Now we're getting a little bit more technical. Might be boring if you have already an idea of how this will work, but if not, let me quickly summarize. So the idea in all the approaches to chess, like AI and so on, to the encoding idea of the game flow is to consider this ever-branching tree. So by tree, I mean you have a node which leads to more nodes and so on and so forth, which gets broader. You see here a picture of this roughly. So I think here this is a tic-tac-toe example of how you have an empty board and then move can be made. And here's some examples of how, like, if you know tic-tac-toe, how this game can progress, right? And in a board game, for example, the bigger the board is, the more options there are, and the broader this evolution can be. So what you want is ways of encoding the game state that will be called S as we go on. So the situation, how the board is, and then you consider, my nose, sorry. And then you consider all the various next step states that can result from that. So for example, here's the trivial initial state of the tic-tac-toe game, and then here are three examples of next situation. And of course, in a game like chess, you always have two players taking parts, like taking turns. And so every branch that will actually be taken, so for example, if we actually in the actual evolution of the game from here to here, is determined by the player, and these players all take turns in changing their state. And the chess algorithm, whether with machine learning or not, will work is by looking at this branching tree. This like has many options, and then making a choice essentially. And this is then of course corresponds to the choice that the artificial intelligence does. And one of the challenges then is, for example, with Go or chess, is handling this sheer vast breadth of choices that could be done, and figuring out, hey, what does it actually mean to make a good choice? And a good choice is of course dependent on what will be a good choice in the next step, and then what will be a good choice in the next step, and if you follow this along, how you actually lead to a state that is a winning state for you. And you have to also then consider, hey, what is the best choice that the opponent can do, and you have to take this into account in your making a decision with you, I mean the AI. And then there are then now a bunch of like code buzzwords that speak for algorithms that make this thing work, like managing this kind of complicated situation. And I collected the major ones of those and will shortly comment on them. Okay, so before we go get actually into algorithms, here's a comparison between different games and game complexities. Can I look at the page, how this is defined in this case? But I found this interesting, that's why I noted. So here you have a bunch of games. I think at the end is chess or so here. And then you have various, like in the columns, you have various, like just facts, some numbers, some characterizations, and then complexity classes for there. So if you're into computer science, then you know kind of these notions maybe already. And so I found this interesting, this page, game complexity. Okay, so again, I'm not the, like, I have not programmed like a game winning program before, especially not with in a machine learning sense. But if you look at this page here, evaluation function, I mean, you can of course always like stop and read it or go to the website and check it out. What we may want to make use of is an evaluation of different the different steps that we can take, the different edges that we can go down on in our node, right? And we need a way to evaluate that. And these are then encoded with kind of likelihoods to, if you go further down that path, that actually eventually will lead to a winning state. So what we will see is that the algorithms, they kind of try to make a decision, for example, by an heuristic, and then in that case, in the Google paper that we will see, go through the end of the game, with, you know, some random ingredients, and then evaluate the different edges to go down on by the, as I said, by this likelihood to win. And for the formalization and comparing different way branches down that you can take, you need this evaluation function. And here is this short comment here, an evaluation function for chess, for example, might take the form, and then you have some coefficients c1, c2, and so on and so forth, and then different like objective or objectively computable characteristics of a state, for example. So materialist is this term that is used for how much figures you have, and what I have seen looking at a bunch of videos is also that people ask, like even in casual chess players assign numbers sometimes to this to the pieces. And so here are some characteristics like king safety, right? That might be used to evaluate different states, and these then enter into making the decision. Okay, so this is a broad topic. Again, I will not dwell on this point too much, apart from not being an expert anyway. But you can see that that will come in handy, right? Okay, and then there are like main algorithms that always pop up if you read into the literature on these topics, and one of them is Minimax. And here this is in the context of, he described in the context of artificial intelligence, and I know it especially also already from decision theory, which also of course is relevant in my field of computer vision. So the idea is here you have a small formula that you have here vi, which is the value function of the player I. And these depend on like to get to some state. I think, let's see. So you are the point, and players can take action, make actions. So AI is the action that you can do. Then A minus I is denotes the action the other player can do, or in this case they say all other players, depends on what kind of game it is. And you have this some evaluation characteristic defined, and minimax is a kind of decision rule or helping rule to that says how about you make you go down that path where given whatever you do and given whatever the other player would most likely do if he wants to win as well, that gives you the best outcome. And the best in this case is the maximum from what you can do of the minimum, because the other player wants to harm you, what he can do. So this is super coarse description, of course, of this principle, but this is so to speak the kind of standard tool that is always used in this branching decisions, and I suppose it's also part of the Stockfish algorithm, although all these algorithms are of course more complicated, but you will not get around this ingredient. And so here, there's a one video by Full Stack Academy, who I think do coding videos, and there is this talker. I don't think his name is listed here right away, but this is a video on the Monte Carlo tree search, which is the approach that DeepMind will take in the paper. And this is a really good, if you're interested in the algorithms, a good video. I really like that. Here he explains the Monte Carlo tree search approach that we will see. And so to quickly summarize that idea in the most broadest strokes is, I kind of alluded to it already, right? So here you look at ways you can go down, ways which are interesting, and there are some comments in the paper what interesting means, and then you make this kind of you restrict the possibilities for what you can do by rolling dice a little bit. You you simulate with random inputs branches to the end, and then as this algorithm explains, and it's kind of an interplay of the exploration of exploitation, where you on the one hand look at different nodes, like different ways you can go down, and then also decide how far you go down with them. Okay, this is not really an algorithm description, but there is this video which makes this a little bit more technical. So this is maybe contrasted to the minimax approach that he also quickly mentions at the beginning of this video. So I guess, if you have never heard about, if you have never heard about chess games and game programming in for that, then here now you have maybe this kind of idea of how that might look like, right? You try to crawl through this giant branch and try to make decisions. On that note, yeah, okay, here's the Wikipedia page on the Monte Carlo search. And here is also another video on. Minimax and then alpha beta pruning. And alpha beta pruning is one of the tools. Firstly, I recommend this video as well. And alpha beta pruning is one of the tools, if you read this short introduction here, also helping you decide which branch to go down, right? Okay. There's a nice history section as well. Yeah, okay. So you see how things come together. And this is also interesting, something that's popped up a couple of times while I researched this a little. I'm not 100% sure how to pronounce it, and I had the feeling that most of the YouTubers, where I tried to see how people pronounce it, I didn't know either. Let's say quiescent search. I think some quiescent search. I think one guy who seemed like he knew what he was talking about. He was a machine learning programmer, but maybe not in this context. And he said he doesn't know, and he just says quiet science, which is probably not right, but I liked it because it goes in the right direction. So this is, as you can read here, also preferential decision criteria, which as is described here, mimics kind of human behavior. And the idea is that you program the algorithm such that you give preference to exploring the moves where a lot of things are happening, where, like, for example, in chess, where pieces are like in danger or attacked. That you give preference to first exploring these options, and then once these are, if I reason correctly about it, then once these are covered and you're sure that you don't miss something crucial, then you can you found your piece, so to speak. Then you go and make your decision there. There's even some pseudocode. I mean, you know, with pseudocode, I think people should just use Python, right? Because Python is usually just as short as pseudocode, and it runs. Okay, so now we are through with the algorithm buzzwords and my short sketch of them. I hope it helped a little bit. There are some games that are noted which the AlphaZero algorithm can also easily learn, and this also kind of shines a light on the different chesses that appear throughout history. So here we see that an ancient Indian strategy game, which is theorized to be a common ancestor of board games like chess. And also Shogi, which is this Japanese chess, which I think is already my second page, which 6, 7, 8, 9. Yeah, so this is a little bit bigger than chess. And if the chessboard is bigger, then of course, but given the same sort of moves as chess or similar moves, then this branching tree will be bigger. And then it gets more complicated. And in that sense, for example, Go is also harder because it has more options. Although in the paper, they noted that difference is that Go has more symmetry, so apparently from at least from the implementation standpoint, it's the rules of Go are there might be some redundancies, and that's why you can get rid of some of this complexity a little bit. Okay, this is Go, and here you see a picture. I think I played this like 3 times in my life. Maybe I should try it out. People seem to like it a lot, even if it's looks straightforward and easy. By that I mean just one type of piece, but okay. And then what we will also see in the paper, and I myself don't know how to read it, although I have an idea, there's this chess notation, right? If you read of a report of a chess game, then it's encoded in with just a few letters and digits to follow the chess games, and they give some examples of chess games that the AlphaZero algorithm played, of course, in this notation. You might have to learn it. Didn't learn it, but I mean, probably it's literally just listing the positions the pieces go to, right? Well, okay. Okay, so we're getting to the end of this long list here. I said before, a lot of these guys that are part of the paper, the authors are already like famous in their own right. Here is this guy Lex Friedman, who has a bunch of videos relating to AI. He's a little bit peculiar, I think, this interviewer, but he is also very sympathetic. And he has all the important guys in the field for sure as interview guests. And this David Silber, who like has also an impressive CV, is probably the first author here also, yeah, is interviews and these people give their views on AI, and then Lex Friedman always like asks deep questions. there's this video, if you're after this video want to watch something more chill instead of doing algorithms, then go there. okay, you know, Wikipedia page, of course. They also have their university homepage because they're affiliated with some uni usually. And there are, like, as you saw, like 10 people. I cannot, like, list all. I will not comment on too much on these guys, but you can explore them. A lot of them have either wiki articles about them or at least chess wiki articles. There's here this happy fellow. Okay. And of course, shout out to Julian, simply because he's a fellow YouTuber, you could say. And yeah, I also, like, I looked up all these the guys that co-wrote the paper, and there's this one guy here who actually, like, is also a chess professional, or was at least, who now is working at DeepMind. Yeah, there's also the chess programming wiki, a little bit more extensive. Okay, so we are finally through with all these links. I'm going to eat a cookie here. Okay, so I have written down a lot of notes also on the pages that I just talked about, but I always forget to look at my own notes when I do these videos. So let's just start by reading the abstract, right? So let me see what you see. Where am I? Okay. So, the game of chess is the most widely studied domain in the history of artificial intelligence. The strongest programs are based on a combination of sophisticated search tree techniques, domain-specific adaptations, and handcrafted evaluation functions that have been refined by human experts over several decades. In contrast, the AlphaGo Zero program recently achieved superhuman performance in the game of Go by tabula rasa reinforcement learning from games of self-play. So self-play is also the feature that is emphasized. As we will see, they emphasize how the thing basically knows nothing a priori, and this is just this architecture which is very versatile. And if you read, for example, the Wikipedia article on DeepMind, this was kind of one of the motivating ideas in even founding the company, I think, to have this very, like, super generalized machine learning tool, not a problem solver in the sense of tuning into one problem, but actually having this general thing. And here, that's why they emphasize here in this abstract already that they contrast themselves against these existing solutions by the fact that AlphaZero in itself is not really even chess related. And it's learning thus in this self-play where you basically, like, if you would learn chess and then you turn on with the board and see what would be the best move from the other side. And in this way, play against yourself and learn. There is, I think it's called the Schach Novelle, the chess novella. There's a super famous novel, actually, of a guy sort of going crazy but playing chess against himself on a boat or something. Okay. In this paper, we generalized this approach. Oh, sorry. In this paper, we generalized this approach into a single AlphaZero algorithm that can achieve tabula rasa superhuman performance in many challenging domains, starting from random play. And given no domain knowledge except the game rules, AlphaZero achieved within 24 hours a superhuman level of play in the game of chess, shogi, Japanese chess, and as well as Go, and convincingly defeated a world champion program in each case. Okay, so this is about making AlphaGo Zero you know, here's this distinction AlphaGo 0 and now AlphaZero, more abstract and previously Go focused. Now this Go focus is away, now it's applicable to various games. And I think in the paper later, like more 2 years later, they extended it to computer games as well, to Atari. And this is a pure self-play, deep reinforcement learning approach. These are the keywords in which you have to look into deeper inside of the machine learning field. Develops game prowess from self-playing only, and learns the value estimate and move probabilities. So the quality of moves is improved by self-learning what's valuable, and this is then encoded with proof probabilities. You will have to read the paper to get into the more technical details. I don't want to say something wrong, but it definitely goes along these lines. And again, they emphasize there's less human tinkering and tuning. Related to that, they speak here about a world champion program in each case. I've already mentioned Stockfish in chess, and other chess programs that they mention will be Elmo and AG0 Free Day. I didn't know about those, but just if you want to look into other programs, apparently Elmo and AG0 are other game solvers that are actively developed, I suppose. Okay, so to the layout, let me quickly browse through the paper, okay? This is the abstract and the main paper. What is very noticeable is that it's nice to have a bunch of pictures, but it's the first six pages is the main paper, okay? And then comes the references already. I should actually make this smaller here. Let me go up again. The paper starts and then they have no sections for six pages. That's what I meant before. It's kind of weird setup. I mean, if the paper would be longer, then I understand these long chapters, but this is like one main chapter and then you have a bunch of pictures and then there's already references. It's kind of unconventional for the papers I read, but okay. However, then you have the references. There are like 32 references or so. These are mostly related to machine learning, of course. And then you have various other sections. So after the table of contents and main and reference, you have, and I read to you here, you have the anatomy of a computer chess program. We will go through these sections in a little bit more detail in a second. But here they kind of define generally, for example, here, talk about Stockfish and what makes, like this is after the main paper, right? This is a kind of appendix explanations. They explain what the ingredients that make for the typical chess program. Then they have this history section that I already mentioned, where they, you know, they start with NeuroChess from this Sebastian so-and-so that I mentioned already. Then talk about Monte Carlo tree search and alpha beta search. They emphasize that Monte Carlo tree search is probably an older algorithm already, but it was never as strong apparently, but here with their deep learning reinforcement learning approach, it suddenly comes to strength, and that's why they choose it. Sorry. And then again, to emphasize how little AlphaZero knows about chess as such, they speak about what is common and what is not part of the AlphaZero setup. Here you see then all the things that they use, which seems little. Representation section on kind of the the layout also. Okay, I will say a little bit more about this in a second. And then basically at page 15, the paper is pretty much over. They state some example games that probably are notable, that how AlphaZero played. And finally, they give some numbers of how quickly Stockfish actually learned to play as good, how quickly AlphaZero learned to play against Stockfish successfully. So they kind of emphasize here, we only took this many games to get as good as it. And so the paper has 19 pages. Okay, so that's the structure. So let me quickly summarize what we see here. It's a little bit disoriented for me. For example, they have an abstract and then there's not even like introduction as first chapter. But okay. So they start out with a little bit history and say that how chess is, I think they even say chess is computer science, as it's the kind of as old as computer science is, like as people started doing chess analysis, like Zermelo and so on. There was, I think it was, what was it, 1913? That was before Gödel even. They report how Deep Blue already beat the world leading human in 97. So 23 years ago, we were already at the point where computers were stronger in chess than humans anyway. So why even do this now? But then they say how, okay, I'm really beating myself here. The current methods are mostly domain specific to the particular games and do this alpha beta pruning with minimax and so on. And then they refer to the methods that will elaborate on the current state in more detail. Okay, and then, yeah. We get some formulas here. It tells us what it is actually that the thing learns. And I'm not going to get into statistics, but if you know a little bit machine learning, or at least statistical physics, then you know this sort of logarithm formulas and you know, risk formulas. It always looks similar. So there's actually no surprise if you look at this kind of thing here. So here, this is the parameters theta that this thing learns, and it evaluates the different states s and gives probabilities for how likely it is that this is being played, something like that. Here they also say that Go might be simpler in a certain sense than chess, given the symmetry, and maybe less figures as well. And then before they before we get to the pictures here, they explain then that they're using this Monte Carlo tree search and compare it against Minimax. See the videos that I referenced. So again, roughly the Monte Carlo tree search at each level, I mean, at each split of options, you determine the interesting nodes and prefer those for further investigations. And whether a node is interesting is to find out whether a node is interesting. This is a kind of iterative process. It's determined by random play of certain nodes to the end. You know, so computer, it can like simulate games with random inputs also, I don't know to what extent these moves are actually done random, or probably random with respect to these values that this function already has learned. But it improves, like it plays against itself at each stage, has these parameters. and based on that makes new decisions and then refines the parameters. That's how the story goes. And then it finds out what is interesting and learns in this way what are the interesting moves and what are the moves to investigate and think deeper. If I say deeper, then I speak about going down the branch to the end, and then, you know, these games take, I don't know, 50 moves or so, and then the game is over. So you can play games to the end and then see what is the, like, assigned numbers, what is the likelihood to win, and so on. The further you, like, determine what's interesting, in a sense, the randomness goes down because you make good moves. And then there's also, I'm not sure if they post it here as well, but on the Wikipedia page, in any case, they're done this expressions in the Monte Carlo search for that kind of weight notes by exploration and exploitation. So the breadth and depth that you go. AlphaZero, then there's a quote that I wrote down. AlphaZero estimates and optimizes the probability of winning, assuming binary win. So again, AlphaGo Zero, so that's the old one, estimates and optimizes the probability of winning, assuming binary win-loss outcomes. AlphaZero, the new one, instead estimates and optimizes the expected outcome, taking into account draws or potentially other outcomes. So I cannot point you to the point in this paper because I've written it down on the side, but there's also where they contrast the general weight that is used in judging and therefore learning the moves, and how this is now been refined or changed, at least from this binary outcomes to taking more probabilities into account. Okay, I'm obviously waving my hand a lot here. So this is in the middle of the page 3. And then another quote: in contrast, AlphaZero simply maintains a single neural network that is updated continually rather than waiting for an iteration to compete. So they also have a different system than previously with regards to when they actually tune these parameters, the theta parameters, for example, in this f function. Yeah, and then we come to this comparison. Here you see with time, essentially, how the algorithm that is trained competes against these different computer programs. So here in chess, shogi, and go, I suppose this is this is Elo ranking. If you don't know chess, this is kind of the way of ranking the strength of chess player. And here you see then, I suppose, the evolution of how it gets stronger, and the point of the plot is, of course, that eventually this blue line hops over the green line, and here you can see when this becomes better than this other existing algorithm that you choose to compete against. I also want to note that, of course, Stockfish is an open source project, and DeepMind is not public. The algorithm is not open, as far as I understand. And they say that AlphaZero searches just 80,000 positions per second in chess and 40,000 in shogi. So if you go on the Wikipedia page also to the result there, I think there is a section on their 2017 result, which is essentially this paper. Some people also initially they said, this is not fair because they surely trained their algorithm on a super machine, like a supercomputer. But then they kind of pushed back on that and said, no, it was actually fair, and they used two similar computers, one for their algorithm versus their Stockfish and so on. Some more numbers on the training and results. And then one of the things I like probably the most in this paper is this page. So here on page 6, they show, I think this is time in learning. So the you see while what the system decides to behave with time while learning. And here you see, I think 10 or so different opening moves, right? So this opening moves that you can do in chess. And here you see the fraction, the percent, it goes from 0 to 25% of games that the AlphaZero opened with this position. So for example, in the end, after 8 minutes, I think this is 8 minutes of learning, I'm not sure, but I think this is the 8 minutes of playing. This English opening where you take the pawn here in c2 and move to c4 is played in about 10% of the time. So this is the most favorable starting point. And they discuss these kind of results under discovering what humans have already kind of figured out, what is actually strong moves and so on. I mean, you know, there's long Wikipedia pages and also YouTube videos on this topic of how to play openings and so on. And they say this is about discovery of human knowledge, rediscovering what is actually a good move and so on. I like this page. Okay, and then this is basically it. And they say then they got better than, I think, Stockfish 8 in this case. And that was the result. Okay, so then the references, and then let me quickly to wrap this up, shortly comment on these other sections. So here they speak about the anatomy of computer chess programs, and again, Stockfish emphasize how this has this handcrafted features. Here they also bring up this quiescent search that they list basically a bunch of algorithm ingredients, and then at the end they say, but AlphaZero doesn't do that. Although they also say that AlphaZero doesn't do that and still won a lot of games eventually. But they also say that if you would actually give the thing more knowledge or tune it a little bit, then you could probably even get more out of it. So they explicitly write that also. Yeah, genau. Okay. Then here, I already said it really. Here you have several historic stepping stones to where we are today. And they are all using this alpha beta search of making decisions. Comment on Monte Carlo tree search. Yeah, previously they have been found to be weaker than the common alpha beta. Alpha beta pruning mini max approach, but here they have this kind of novel averaging technique, and they kind of combine it with this deep neural network. And then here the idea is that this Monte Carlo research actually shines and is better and works out well. Okay. In this section, they for example say that the neural network architecture is matched to the grid structure as a board. So this is a technical implementation detail that, if you know a little bit about these layers in the machine learning, deep learning process here, that you have a kind of representation, a very direct representation apparently from the actual chessboard for this thing. Or at least it's learned that way. In any case, because it ought not to be so. I don't know which point, of course, you know, you have this general algorithm and then you decide, well, now I want to use it for chess. So you have to give it the chess rules. And I am not so sure if the layers of the deep neural network then also are tuned, or if just the numbers are tweaked. So if, for example, if you know some Python TensorFlow and have 1 point, pick together a machine learning algorithm, which is not that hard. Maybe a little bit hard to understand if you don't know the math, but at least to plug together the modules, it's more or less straightforward. And I suppose then in that case, apart from also giving it the chess rules, they also tune in numbers that sort of correspond to the chessboard. Yeah, here the network architecture is described. And yeah, here is some specialization. I think this is the sections where they explain how the architecture then is specified from the general algorithm that they advertise to particular games that it then learns. Yeah. Here's more some numbers for learning, some parameter tunings of the general algorithm. And at the bottom, I think, sorry, if we go down of page 18, this is related to the configuration section is represented dead, and here you see then this evaluation speed tables where they emphasize that they only have this 18k to get good. Here in the evaluation section, finally, they give descriptions of how the ELO ranking system for chess is used in the statistics and versus other algorithms. So here you see some ELO ranking and statistics formulas. And then they give the examples. Okay, so I hope that was interesting. As I said, I will. There's two things. On the one hand, I want to do constructive set theory videos again. I will not do so much chess, but I hope I find the time to play some more chess. Sadly, I basically don't have too much time, but I already asked some people at work to play a little bit chess for me with me. Although to play it physically is at the moment difficult because of Corona restrictions. So otherwise, you have always to disinfect the chess pieces. But I will probably go on playing with my working colleagues. And other than that, I'm part of the, I do this algebraic geometry course where I'm not too strong in, but I'm very much looking forward to that. Maybe it will turn out that I will make videos on algebraic geometry if something falls out from that. Okay, so subscribe to the video. Thanks for watching. Leave a comment if you made it through this hour, and take care.